Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the day two of the 78th annual convention of STAI. With this, we are going to start the proceedings of the day two session. First, we will start with the Mr. Mangal Singh Memorial Lecture, for which the guest speaker, Mr. R.L. Tamak, Executive Director and CEO, DCM Shriram Industries Limited, DCM Shriram Limited, is with us. And I would also like to request Mr. G. Venkateshwar Rao, the co-chairman of the session, to please switch on his camera. I would like to hereby welcome our honorable chairman for the session, Mr. D.K. Goyal, honorary editor, STAI. The co-chairman for the session, Mr. M.S. Sundaram, managing director, J.P. Mukherjee Associates Private Limited, and Mr. G. Venkateshwar Rao, vice president, STAI, and chief operating officer of KCP Sugar Industries and Corporation Limited. With this, I would like to request Mr. D.K. Goyal to start the proceedings of the session, sir. Sir, over to you, sir.
First of all, I welcome my colleagues, Dr. Sundaram and Mr. Venkateshwar Rao on the dais. Both are distinguished persons in the industry. And I hope to take this session forward. I am very stickler for time. Therefore, we have half an hour for the Mangal Singh Memorial Lecture, and subsequently we have 9 papers to be covered over 3 hours. And therefore, 20 minutes have been allotted to each speaker. After 17 to 18 minutes, there will be a reminder to every speaker so that he can wind up his paper in the next 2 minutes. I have the privilege of introducing my distinguished speaker today, Mr. Roshan Lal Tamak, Executive Director and CEO, Sugar Business of DCM Shriram Limited. He is a person who has worked both in the field, in the factory, and also in the corporate office. In India and abroad, he had worked with multinationals. He has worked with leading groups in India. He does not need a very detailed introduction. Everybody, most of us know him very well. I had the privilege of spending nights in 2 projects in UP with him during commissioning. And I find him to be a great human being, apart from being a stickler to the norms in commissioning the plants. Mr. Roshan Lal Tamak, you are welcome. We invite you now to make your presentation on Mangal Singh Memorial Lecture. Mr. Tamak.
Thank you, Goyalji. Mr. Sundaram and Mr. Venkateshwar Rao, it is a privilege today to deliver this Mangal Singh Ji Memorial Lecture. Mr. Mangal Singh was a legend, and in fact, I was fortunate to interact with him very closely when he was Chief Executive of Bajaj Hindustan, and I was General Manager of a plant of DCM Shriram in his neighborhood. He was not only a great technocrat, but also a very deep thinker, voracious reader, and above all, an inspiring leader. And we all learned from him during his lifetime. So it is really a privilege, and thanks STI and Mr. Sanjay Awasthi in particular for providing me in this opportunity to interact with you all this morning. Now I shall be sharing my presentation, and my topic is sustainability in sugar business, way forward and challenges. So this topic is very, very relevant. And this is an eternal topic. Sustainability, of course, So basically, this is an eternal subject, and this is quite important for any organization to be sustainable. Today, essentially, I shall like to cover the pillars of sustainability. Of course, I will be detailing the importance of sugar sector in Indian context, the challenges, and what has been the technological advancements and the policy initiatives by both federal government and state governments, and of course, what is the way forward. As far as sustainability goes, we all define sustainability in our own way, but the universally acceptable definition of sustainability rests on three pillars, that is societal, environmental, and economical. And it revolves around three things: people, planet, and profit. And if you summarize this in one line, the business can be termed as sustainable if it is socially responsible, environmentally sustainable, and economically viable. So within this framework, we shall try to analyze where does sugar industry stand today as far as Indian context is concerned, what are the challenges, and what is the way forward. Indian sugar sector is a tremendous contributor to the rural economy of India. This is the largest sector in food processing sector as far as India is concerned. We have approximately 600 sugar mills scattered all over the country. And most of these sugar mills, in fact, are located in rural hinterland. So therefore, their contribution to the rural livelihood and economy is very, very momentous. It supports directly about 50 million farmers and their families. The turnover is more than 1.25 lakh crores annually. And approximately 5 million hectare land is under sugarcane cultivation. There are more than 5 lakh workers directly employed in all the sugar mills. And above all, we are a great contributor to the national energy security by providing 2 billion liters of ethanol, which is approximately 5 to 6% of the petrol we consume in our vehicles. We also supply approximately 3,000 clean and green power by our cogeneration plants. And above all, we produce about 26 to 32 million tons sugar annually, and out of which approximately 26 million is consumed by our population. Sugarcane is a wonderful crop, and so this industry is. We not only provide fuel, we also provide fiber, we also provide food, and a lot of energy. And not only to human being, but also the Mother Earth also, in the form of biomass, and water also back goes back to the soil. So this is a wonderful industry to be in. And the concept of circular economy is very beautiful in this, it is very beautifully relevant in this case, because everything of sugarcane is used. And it is a perfect example and classical example of circular economy. Just have a look at some worrying trend. The worrying trend is sugar consumption. If you see this graph critically, the per capita consumption, global, I'm talking of global level, is going down. And that too, in spite of GDP growth and population growth. However, we all know that there is a direct linkage of GDP growth with sugar consumption. Sugar consumption goes up when GDP growth is there. But this is really a worrying trend. And this trend is at global level, and you must be knowing that 14 countries so far have imposed sugar taxes. In fact, sugar has been painted as villain, that this is the problem of all our issues, health issues. But there is no empirical evidence of sugar being harmful to health. My earnest request to all the sugar fraternity members, all the sugar millers, that right picture should be, right facts and figures should be given, placed before the consumers, and then ultimately it is the consumer choice. But no malicious campaign should be launched against any commodity. Let's have a look on where does India stand in terms of cost of production. If you see this chart, the cost of cane, which constitutes about 65 to 80% of the total sugar production cost in various geographies, and the major portion is of course cane. In India, the cane cost is the highest in the world. It is $42 per ton of cane, whereas in Brazil, Thailand and Australia, it ranges from $24 to $27 per ton of cane. So the key message from this slide is that how can India be competitive in terms of exports? India can never be export competitive because our cane costs are higher without government subsidy. So this is a key message out of this. And of course, we fully appreciate the socio-economic context of any particular country. That is very relevant. But this is a fact and this is a reality. So we have to make our policies, our planning in view of this. As far as India goes, if you have seen these figures earlier also, last 4 or 5 years, consistently we are producing more than our consumption. Previously, India was known for its infamous sugar cycle. But now that cycle is not there at all. We are producing more than we consume. So India is a surplus producer now. And there are obvious reasons for that. One, of course, relative economics of sugarcane cultivation is much superior than any other cropping pattern. This is fundamental. Second, sugarcane crop is a hardy crop. It can withstand climatic calamities and its assured disposal is there. And of course, government is very supportive, industry is very proactive in developing cane, in increasing yield. And of course, very lately, this 238 variety developed by Dr. Bakshiram has really contributed to this excess production, higher productivity level, and higher sugar productivity also. So all this has a combined effect and we are producing more than we consume. So what to do about it? The basic issue I shall be touching in the subsequent slides, there are only two options. One is export, second is ethanol. Export is of course short-term measure due to some guidelines, international trade agreements, but of course ethanol is a viable and sustainable solution and that is the only way out in fact. Now I shall like to touch upon the basic fundamental input side factors which affect sugarcane production. And first and foremost comes to my mind is water consumption. Water is an essence, water is essence of life. We all know that. But what is the situation as far as India is concerned? Niti Aayog had published one report last year, and this is very alarming. This is a warning signal. 54% of our area is water stress. Not only water stress, high to extremely high water stress areas. This map of India and painted in red is an indication of that. This is truly, let's take a pause for a while. If we don't consume water for 2 hours, what will happen to us? But we have seen that water has been transported to our cities last year. And this is in front of us. In our life cycle only, water is just receding. Water table is going down and down. Even in Punjab and Haryana, which was having abundance of underground water, there also water has depleted. And we reside in India, there are 17% population of the globe. And we have only 4% fresh water. So how it is sustainable? In no way. Our demand will also multiply. It is expected that it will be doubled by 2030 because of industrialization, because of urbanization, because of processing, everything. In developed countries, the consumption of water is much more than the developing countries. Drinking water, it is estimated. When I see this figure, this really raises my this alarm bells. No drinking water will be available to 40% of the population if we don't act today. We don't take drastic steps to to conserve water. And water crisis obviously will be having a very hard-hitting impact on GDP, everything revolves around water. So my dear friends, we are in agriculture, we are in factory process, we are in processing. It is our duty to conserve water, not only in factory, but also in farm. As a responsible corporate citizen, this is our duty to conserve water. You see the impact of water. In southern states like Tamil Nadu, I have taken example of two states, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. What has happened? Mr. Goyal is over here. He's a veteran of the industry. And Mr. Sundaram is there, who hails from South India. They have seen, and all of us have seen, factories running in Tamil Nadu for more than 300 days a year. So what has happened? What is the status today? The status is in front of us. The industry is in bad shape, and basically due to water crisis, and it has aggravated due to the climatic vagaries. Continuous drought has aggravated the situation. But the basic issue is that water has reduced drastically, underground water has reduced drastically. And of course, there are other issues as also, like labor availability for farm operations. But main issue is water shortage. So this can play havoc if water is not conserved. This situation will be really very uphill and cannot be tackled. It will be an irreversible situation. The other challenge is on input side, on production side, is variety. In last 3 decades or 4 decades, we can count good varieties on our fingertips, like 86032 in Western India, like CO64 in Northern India. Again, 238 is there, CO671 is there. But how many varieties? In 4 decades, 4, 5, 6, 7 varieties. This is not enough. There has to be a robust pipeline of good varieties so that the productivity of sugarcane and sugar both is high. How we have experienced very recently, what is the impact of 238? Industry has benefited, farmers have benefited, everybody has benefited. Variety can be a game changer, but we need to support our researchers, support our academic institutions, and support our scientists so that they can produce good pipeline of promising varieties. And it has to be throughout. It should not be an occasional breakthrough. It has to be throughout. So this is one aspect. Second, of course, labor. Labor, we are seeing the trend of urbanization and industrialization, both. And the rural migration from rural India to urban cities. So there is labor shortage for farm operations. In any case, there is no attraction for youth for agriculture due to obvious reason. So we need to work on 3-4 areas. One, ease of doing agriculture. How can we ease operations of doing agriculture by use of mechanization? This is one clear area of intervention. Second, of course, is that how can we institutionalize mechanization in terms of development of micro-entrepreneurship at village level so that everybody is having access to mechanization. So this is the only way that we can tackle this labor shortage issue. In all across the globe, we have seen mechanization at a very faster rate. But here in India, somehow we have misunderstood mechanization as tractorization. Tractorization is not mechanization. Mechanization has to be from end to end, right from field preparation to harvesting. There have to be some policy changes. Yesterday also I mentioned in my speech at STA convention that this extraneous matter, which comes along with sugarcane in mechanically harvested cane, is in the range of 8 to 10%. It may vary. So until unless policy changes is done to allow 8 to 10% reduction on account of extraneous matter, this mechanical harvesting cannot pick up. And without this, I really see a challenge in terms of sustainability of sugarcane cultivation. Third is soil. Soil is the essence of agriculture. Without good soil, we cannot have good crop. There are issues of integrated nutrient management also. There are issues that organic carbon is depleting at a very faster rate. We are not replenishing back as much as it should have been. So there has to be a comprehensive strategy where we add to the soil, Mother Earth, back what we take out of it. In terms of press mud, we are fortunate to have press mud. We are fortunate to operate in hinterland where a lot of biomanure, biomass is available. We should devise action plans so that organic carbon is sent back to the Mother Earth and our soil is good and it can give us good yield forever. So that should be our endeavor. Now let's touch upon the factory part. And here, you have seen the evolution of this industry. There has been drastic improvement. And my compliments and congratulations to the entire technical fraternity, including our consultant, our technology suppliers, technocrats, academic institutes like National Sugar Institute and Vasandhada Institute. And out of the cumulative efforts of all these persons and agencies and organizations, our technology, our suppliers, our technocrats are regarded well all across the globe. And figures speak themselves. There is a lot of improvement in all spheres of operations, whether it is lossage reduction, or it is steam consumption, or it is power consumption, in our sugar quality improvement. There is all around improvement. My heart goes for all the technocrats who have done a lot of hard work and labor in bringing this bringing these operational benchmarks as far as our operations are concerned. So this is a good work in terms of equipment also. There have been a lot of additions, whether it is continuous span, which is variable frequency drive, or in steam consumption also. If you see high pressure boilers, energy efficient turbines. So these are all have been very, very heartening developments. And as a result of this, there is drastic improvement in steam consumption level also, power consumption also, and now in water consumption also. There is a lot of reduction in water consumption as well. And it has contributed to the growth of the industries, like anything. Like for example, if you take the case of cogeneration, cogeneration has thrived over this high pressure system. And unfortunately, this wave is not continuing now. It could continue only for 20 years. But for 20 years, industry certainly benefited out of this. It practically started in 1990. And today, approximately 2000, it actually fructified. But later on, now a lot of states have, or DISCOMs have reduced the power tariff, due to which its attractiveness has gone down. But this has paid dividends. And waste to wealth was generated. The bagasse, which was a difficulty to handle. And we produced out of this power out of this. And as I mentioned in my opening remarks, that approximately 3000 megawatt power we are giving to the national grid. By any means, this is an immense contribution of the industry. And thanks again to the technology, to our technocrat and our institutions like NSI and VSI. As far as environment goes, there are issues related to environment, whether it is soil management, solid waste management, or it is air emission, or it is water effluent. So basically, in all these three areas, my dear friends, let's be mindful that going forward, these environmental norms will be stricter and stricter. Industry has taken up all these initiatives to reduce emission norms also, and also reduce the effluent quantity. But going forward also, you should gear up yourself, and otherwise also, as a responsible corporate citizen, it is our duty to that waste is reduced, emissions are reduced, and we take care of the ecology and the environment. We should take all steps to reduce this pollution footprint. Now, let's take a pause for a while and touch upon that, because policy plays a great role in particularly in a regulated industry context. And sugar industry is highly regulated. And the basic concern of the government is to take care of the farmers, take care of the industry, take care of the consumers. So the industry is regulated. Our sale is regulated. Cane price is also fixed by the government. And also minimum selling price of the sugar is also fixed by the government. And so are the ethanol prices. So a lot of good policy initiatives have been taken by the government recently, particularly this minimum selling price of sugar. This is a historic policy initiative. Second is exports have been incentivized. And it is a very good news that India exported 6 million ton last year. And this is the highest ever export. In terms of on ethanol front also, very welcome policies. Offtake is ensured, prices have been revised, mandate is also, there is streamlining of the processes also, and there is a talk going on for increasing the blending mandate also. So lot of policies and positive policies by government of India as well as state governments. So this is really supporting the sector. And but the continuity, predictability, and assurance of the policies is required. And my ask to the policymakers is that we should have a policy framework which is sustainable, predictable, and assuring in the times to come. So what more we want from the policymakers? The basic is this cane pricing policy. There has to be a rational cane pricing policy, some linkage with the product realization, so that a balance is maintained between farmers' profitability and also the industry viability. So there could be many models. This needs to be debated a little bit. But essentially the core issue is that there has to be some linkage somewhere. Sugar export policy has to be announced, because production is just starting very soon. In terms of ethanol, there is already a lot of work is going on, and hopefully a tender has been floated for 5 years. Long-term offtake guarantees has been given by the OMC. So already there is a lot of positive momentum. Financial assistance has been announced by Government of India for setting up new plants. This is a welcome move. However, on cogeneration front, there is an issue. Power tariff reduction has been done, which have made this sector unviable, the cogeneration particularly. In terms of land, there are three areas where we need reforms. One is adoption of Modern Land Leasing Act. Second is mechanical harvesting, because mechanical harvesting is this extraneous matter reduction, it has to be done. And third, of course, to conserve water for drip irrigation, more allocation, budgetary allocation for sugarcane crops should be done. And this is my last slide. I have summarized all the points over here. So in terms of policy, just to summarize quickly, two areas. Export needs to be incentivized, MSP of sugar to be hiked appropriately, and revenue sharing formula in some form or the other has to be put into place. In terms of value addition, cogeneration needs support. Ethanol, lot of movement is there. This movement should continue. In terms of value addition, compressed biogas is another stream which I'm clearly seeing in next 4-5 years, it will certainly be on the ground. Refined sugar segment, further value addition, what could be the possibilities in many forms of the sugar. And downstream chemicals is another area which industry should explore. as far as technology is concerned, we should strive hard to again to reduce steam consumption, water consumption, effluent reduction, and we should have a strategy in place that how can we convert waste into wealth. This should be our motto, and waste minimization should be our motto. As far as clean development goes, basically there has to be a pipeline of promising varieties. This is first and foremost. We should improve soil health, give thrust on mechanization, and water conservation has to be on top of our priority. With all these words, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to interact with you all this morning. Thank you very much.
Very well done, Mr. Tamar, both content and time. And may I request Mr. Venkateshwar Rao, who is also similarly placed in Andhra Pradesh, to say a few words. And in the meantime, if there are any questions in the chat box, Mr. Tamak can have a look at it, and then after Mr. Venkateshwar Rao, he can answer those questions.
Good morning, Chairman, Co-Chairman, and Tamak ji, and fellow delegates. Sorry for the delay in joining. I was sitting in puja. Anyhow, thank you so much, Tamak ji. You have nicely narrated about the world industry and then Indian sugar industry, and particularly our contribution to the rural India. So the main problems of excess sugar production and high cost of cane cultivation. So excess sugar production, as you rightly said, exports and ethanol are the only solutions right now. But the cane high cost of cane cultivation, the problem is not universal across the country, because high recovery in northern part and low recovery in southern part. So as we were also thinking in the similar lines, like soil health management, vertical growth and mechanization, because I gave a presentation to Sugarcane Breeding Institute, Acharya Engineering Agricultural University, in the year 2008 itself. So what are the research areas to be taken up? So there itself, soil health management, vertical growth and mechanization were given. So likewise, we started working. We established a soil health lab here, and then biggest biotechnology center in KCP. We worked with the National Vermi Institute, Chennai. So we educated the farmers for soil health management. The organic carbon levels in Andhra Pradesh used to be around 0.5%. With our good support and then management support as well as farmer support, it was taken up to 0.8 to 0.9. But still it is not sufficient. The difference between the cost of cultivation between north and south is, the one is low recovery, other one is the high labor cost. As I was telling in the earlier meetings also, the cost of harvesting and transport here, it is 1200, whereas in northern part I heard it is only 600. But you have nicely narrated about the problems like water problem, variety, alternatives. Particularly yesterday also you were mentioning in the inaugural session, alternative for 238, that is a must immediately have to taken up. And regarding the low-cost harvester development, it is very much needed for southern part immediately, whereas for, I think, northern part also, the problem may be serious in the next few years, as you have already rightly pointed out. And KCP, along with Sugarcane Breeding Institute and Engineering Agriculture University, also started working on this. Hope we will come out with some solution maybe in the next year, sir. Thank you, sir. Back to Goel ji, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Tamak, do you have any questions in your chat box?
There's no questions in the chat box, sir.
No questions. No,
only suggestion is there, I think.
Now it has come to.
Anoop has shared one suggestion, and I fully support that 70% water is there in sugarcane. And we should conserve water in processing also, and give back this water to soil or for potable purpose. So that should be our agenda. And in fact, as I mentioned, that sugarcane is a wonderful crop. Its biomass, its water, everything goes back to the soil, can go back to the soil. So this should be our endeavor. I fully support Anoop ji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, may I have your permission to thank Mr. Tamak for an excellent presentation. And